Some people corner the market on a trait so thoroughly that their name becomes synonymous with it. Like if you call someone a Benedict Arnold, you're calling them a traitor. And Albert Einstein means genius. Sometimes sarcastically. Scientists have been fascinated by what made Einstein a genius for decades, and what it can tell us about intelligence in general. So fascinated, in fact, that it led one of them to take his brain without permission, which opened the door to it becoming the most studied brain in history. You don't need to be Albert Einstein to understand how wrong that was, but quite a few researchers really wanted to know, was there anything special about Einstein's brain? Einstein died in 1955 at the age of 76 from a ruptured abdominal aortic aneurysm. At the time, he was living in Princeton, New Jersey. He had technically retired 10 years before, but was still actively doing physics research and humanitarian work. Einstein told his doctors that he didn't want to prolong his life artificially and made it known that he wanted to be cremated. And he was. Mostly. After his aneurysm, he was taken to a hospital in Princeton where he died. At that point, his body was wheeled away for an autopsy. But the pathologist on call that day removed his brain during the autopsy and saved it, thinking it would be valuable to study while the rest of his body was sent on for cremation. Einstein had never given consent for his brain to be used for scientific purposes, and the pathologist didn't get permission from the family at first either. When one of Einstein's sons found out, he was understandably angry. But the doctor was later able to convince the son to give permission for the brain to be preserved so he and others could study it. And boy, did they study it! The first paper was published in 1985, 30 years after Einstein died, which seems like a really long time, right? Well, we'll get back to that later. The first paper focused on glia, cells in the nervous system that aren't neurons and don't send electrical messages. There are several kinds of glia, but they're all support cells for the neurons. They hold neurons in place, form the coating that helps neurons send messages more quickly, bring neurons nutrients, and basically act as an immune system for the brain. The paper compared Einstein's brain to the brains of 11 other men, and reported that Einstein's had more glial cells compared to neurons in the inferior parietal lobe than the controls did. This area of the brain is involved in complex language skills and may also be involved with performing calculations. So they proposed that Einstein needed more glia per neuron in that area because his neurons worked harder than most people's. Working harder requires more energy and therefore more glia to bring them nutrients. The paper reported that the control brains averaged roughly one glia for every two neurons, while for Einstein the ratio was closer to 1:1. Today, neuroscientists believe that the ratio of glia to neurons in Einstein's brain was actually typical. Most brains have that 1:1 ratio of glia to neurons. But what would it mean if Einstein did have more glia than usual? There's some evidence that more glia compared to neurons is related to the size of neurons, but it's not connected to intelligence. There were also some major issues with this study. Like, sure, they found a smaller neuron to glia ratio in the inferior parietal lobe than in the controls, but that's not the only place they looked. They saw no differences in neuron to glia ratio in the three other brain areas they looked in. They also didn't just look at neuron to glia ratio, and they saw no differences in any of the six other ways they counted cells. In other words, they looked at seven different factors in four different brain areas for a total of 28 comparisons, and they only found a significant difference in one of them. So there's a decent chance that this finding was a false positive. Einstein was also 76 when he died, and the average age of the control brains was 64. The control individuals were also patients who died at a Veterans Administration hospital, and while none of them died from neurological disease, military service historically hasn't been kind to brains. So it's tough to say that any differences between them were indicative of Einstein's smarts. farts and not some other factor. On top of all that, a different paper argued that not only was a different neuron to glia ratio in his inferior parietal lobe not what made him a genius, it's actually what caused his dyslexia. Those researchers referenced work that shows that damage in this area is associated with the reading disorder. If Einstein's ratio of cells really was different than other people's, that could be related. Except we can't say for sure that Einstein actually had dyslexia. He was never diagnosed, and the belief that he was dyslexic comes from anecdotes he and his family recounted later in his life, and memories aren't always accurate. Even if he did have dyslexia, the ties between this brain area and dyslexia aren't as direct as this hypothesis suggests. So, okay, it doesn't seem like glia can account for Einstein's intelligence. The next thing researchers looked at was his neurons. But before I tell you more about that, let's take a quick break.
Thanks to Kinsta for supporting this SciShow video. Kinsta is a managed hosting for WordPress service dedicated to delivering exceptional speed, security, and reliability to businesses that depend on WordPress websites. And they've been doing this since 2013, so they've been around the block a time or two. In that time, they've figured out how to get their customers up to 200% faster sites, guaranteed with the highest level of security for a website to protect your data. Since the whole point of having your own website is to make it unique to serve your specific needs, Kinsta offers MyKinsta, a custom dashboard to update the way you manage your site. And that should be more intuitive than the old way you used to operate, but if you ever need customer support, Kinsta provides human-only chats that respond in a matter of minutes in multiple languages. We know people all over the world watch SciShow, and Kinsta has you all covered. Their 37 data centers and counting allow users to select the region that best serves their audience. And with a global content delivery network operating across more than 260 locations, they can instantly deliver content worldwide. Kinsta is offering new customers their first month free on select plans, giving you plenty of time to experience Kinsta's high-performance hosting with no limitations and at zero cost. You can find that deal at the link in the description or at sponsor.is/Kinsta_SciShow. That's sponsor, sponsor.is/Kinsta_SciShow.
A second study in 1996 looked at a slice of Einstein's right prefrontal cortex. This area of the brain is involved in a lot of complex tasks, like emotional regulation, understanding what other people are thinking and feeling, and planning things out. This study did a little better with the age of the controls, comparing Einstein's brain to 5 men with an average age of 68. It found that while the samples of Einstein's prefrontal cortex had the same number of neurons as the controls, the cortex itself was much thinner. In other words, the neurons were packed in more densely, which was curious. The brain sections were preserved and prepared in the exact same way, so that probably couldn't explain the difference. The controls were also elderly men, which meant that any age-related effects should be relatively equal. So the researchers suggested that a higher density of neurons could lower the amount of time it took to send messages between them, which might allow for faster processing. And faster processing could mean more smarts. But there were a few issues with this study and its interpretation too. First, a study the next year looked at a different part of Einstein's brain, the superior temporal gyrus, and reported that there was no difference in cortical depth in that area. To be fair, given the tasks that the prefrontal cortex is involved in, there could be something about it specifically when it comes to intelligence. It has a role in some pretty intense cognitive skills, so the hypothesis that denser neurons gives you some sort of advantage seems reasonable. Except, there's no evidence that denser neurons in the prefrontal cortex boosts those skills. In fact, there is evidence that people with schizophrenia may have denser neurons in that area. Einstein didn't have schizophrenia, but you can see how hard drawing conclusions from this kind of thing can be. So the density of neurons in his prefrontal cortex was probably not what made Einstein a genius. Researchers then turned to the shape and structure of his brain. In 1999, a group of them looked looked at photographs of Einstein's brain to determine whether there were any differences in the gyri and sulci of his brain compared to other people's. Those are the bumps and valleys that make our brains look wrinkly, and neuroscientists use them as the boundaries that define certain areas of the brain. For example, the primary motor cortex can be found on the ridge right in front of the central sulcus. These researchers reported that Einstein's brain had a larger inferior parietal lobule than usual, and that his supramarginal gyrus didn't have the typical groove running through it. This particular gyrus is thought to be important in speech and language processing, and the researchers suggested that differences in this area could mean that a larger chunk of his brain was deeply connected. And more connection could mean more intelligence. But other scientists looked at the same pictures and thought Einstein's brain looked exactly like everyone else's, going so far as to say that his parietal lobes were so normal, it looked like a picture in a textbook. There was a lot of back and forth as researchers argued over who was looking at the brain incorrectly. And a decade later, a researcher on Team Yes, It's Different proposed that his large parietal lobes might have contributed to more ability to do mathematical and spatial tasks. They also observed what they called a knob in his right precentral gyrus. This area is involved with processing the sensation of touch, but changes in this area have also been associated with musicians. And Einstein was an accomplished violinist. So while it seems unlikely that Einstein's gyri made him a genius in physics, there may be some relationship with his musical talent. Undeterred by the lack of success so far, one final group of researchers decided to focus on Einstein's corpus callosum. This is the large bundle of nerves that connects the two hemispheres of the brain, allowing them to communicate and pass information back and forth. Einstein's corpus callosum was bigger than that of other men his age, and in some measures, it was even bigger than men 50 years younger. The researchers interpreted it as Einstein having more connections between his two hemispheres, resulting in unique mathematical and spatial skills. Now, there is some evidence that having a larger back section of the corpus callosum correlates with higher scores on IQ tests. We won't get into the problems with IQ tests as a measure of intelligence here, but there is at least a connection between the size of that part of the brain and those tests. Except in Einstein's case, it wasn't just the back portion of his corpus callosum, the whole thing was bigger, and we really don't know what that means. I mean, if the whole thing was bigger, you'd expect the back to be bigger too. And it's possible that a bigger corpus callosum allows for more information transfer between the two sides. So Einstein could have put information from different areas of the brain together more effectively, but we just don't know. So after all these studies, we still don't have many answers, and there are some serious issues with the whole body of literature. First, none of the studies of Einstein's brain were blinded, so the observers knew whether they were looking at a control brain or Einstein's brain. That's not great scientific practice, because bias can slip in and color the findings, and a lot of the results have been influenced by what we know about Einstein. For example, he once explained that for him, thinking didn't just involve images and feelings, but was also experienced in his muscles. Researchers brought this up in light of findings of Einstein having a larger area of the motor cortex associated with the face and tongue. But they didn't go into the study looking for something that might explain this description of how he thought. Instead, they noticed a difference and then went through Einstein's life to see if there was something that difference could explain. And some researchers argue that's also not great practice. Plus, we only have information about Einstein's brain from when he was 76 years old. You'd expect there to be some changes from when he was younger, so we don't know which of these features he always had, and which may have been special to the 76-year-old version of his brain. And the cherry on top of all this is that Einstein died in 1955, and the first study didn't come out until 1985. And like I hinted earlier, that's a suspiciously long time. The pathologist who kept the brain had been studying it that whole time, and didn't publish anything because he didn't find anything unusual. That's a lot of negative results before finally finding a difference. And it's going to be really difficult to ever draw conclusions about intelligence from one brain, no matter how smart it was. With a sample size of one, we can't tell what's a feature of his intelligence and what's just a weird thing about Einstein's brain. And all brains have unique features, not just those of geniuses. Intelligence is so complex that scientists can't even agree on what it is, much less boil it down to one anatomical feature that's responsible for one particular trait. That's just not how brains work. And even if we could find some bit of Einstein's brain that directly tied into his genius, it would probably only tell us about specific skills that Einstein had, not about intelligence as a whole. So it's pretty safe to say that the keys to intelligence probably aren't hidden somewhere in the structure of Einstein's brain. But I mean, the guy gave us general and special relativity, so I think he's done enough.